two really special guests with us tonight. Sir Richard Eyre, who's honorary president of Rose Bruford College, always visits us when he can, and enough said. So we have a director and we have an actor.
I've directed.
And I've acted.
Yes, you have, yeah.
Okay, I'm not going to say any more, just to say that we're going to bring this to a halt at some point, their conversation, and allow you to ask questions. I'm sure you have many. After the event, we have a bar set up outside, cheap drinks, £1. You must have a coin. And the college is picking up the rest of the tab.
Well done.
And these two wonderful guys will stay around as long as they can. This event is being streamed tonight, and there will be questions afterwards that you can send in on #ask Ian, I-A-N, Mckellen, M. This is important, because when I was in publishing, I made a mistake and spelt the last name wrong. It's Mckellen. Ask Ian Mckellen if you want to send in any questions at the end. So over to you. Bye bye.
Thank you.
Well, we're going to demonstrate how difficult it is to do theatre in the round. So, this is the reason when you see productions that are in the round, people are always doing that, and it can be quite annoying.
Oh. So,
and you get giddy. Now, Ian said to me, actually characteristically, just before we started, he said, do you think they'll know who I am?
No.
I said, no, probably not.
I'm not always sure who I am, Richard. Sometimes I wake up in the morning, I think.
Who am I? The curse of an actor,
yes,
isn't it?
It is. Yeah.
But the other thing you said as we were walking across, as we were rather excited to see this queue, we thought it was the overflow. Long line outside. The other thing you said was that, in your view, acting became easier the older you got.
Yeah.
Why was it so hard when you were so young?
Oh, yes. Well, it's the pain of acting, actually. I suppose because I didn't go to an academy where I might have picked up a method of some sort. I've never had one. Now, it's not unique to me, but it does mean that every time I start rehearsing something, I don't quite know what I'm doing. And I'm very, very dependent on a director's help. And if that's forthcoming, well, that's good, but sometimes it isn't. And if the part's a difficult one, and I would have decided to play it probably because it was difficult, because I do like a challenge. I think it brings out the best in me. I don't want to do anything I've done before. Nevertheless, there'll come a moment at the end of the first week of rehearsal when you finally are standing up and doing it, when I think, I don't know what this part's about, and if I do, I can't relate to him, and I don't know how to get inside him or get him inside me, whichever is the appropriate image. I did a rather quizzical look with my lips there, which you missed. So I'll repeat it.
Um.
And then pain comes in. And before you ran the National Theatre, it was run by Peter Hall, who had gone off, as was his wont, to direct opera somewhere else in the world. And I was doing a play based on Chekhov's first play about Platonov, which I do recommend to you. It's a wonderful, long, long play, which can be delved into and has been very successfully by a variety of writers. And ours was Michael Frayn, who turned it into a wonderful comedy, Wild Honey. And I was up night after night after night asking questions that I couldn't get sensible answers to. He's a drunk, the character I was playing. He's also a teacher. I couldn't find out what he taught, whether he enjoyed teaching, where he trained as a teacher. Any of the little simple hooks that might have grappled me to the character. And by the time we were ready to meet an audience, I called up Peter Hall, who was in Bayreuth, and said, I don't think this production is worthy of the National Theatre, and I don't want to open in it. Is it possible for us to cancel? Well, of course it's not possible to cancel them. But, you know, that was the depths of my angst. And Peter, the politician, said, I quite understand. Can you just give it 2 or 3 weeks? Just do a couple of previews, and I'll come back and I'll have a look, and we'll sort it all out. And reassured by that emollience, I went on that night to do the first preview and discovered that it was a comedy. I hadn't realised that the only reason for doing the play was to make people laugh, or basically. And that a lot of the lines that I was having a difficulty with, Michael Frayn knew had been written to get a laugh. Well, then the danger was to make sure that I didn't play it as a comedy thereafter, which would have been disastrous. It ran for 18 months at the National Theatre, ingloriously went to Broadway, where we lasted very short length of time, but that sort of difficulty, I feel
you always do that.
I know.
You always, I mean, the last time we worked together was, we did a film for television with, this was uniting Gandalf and Hannibal Lecter in The Dresser. And
well, not reuniting them, but introducing them. They'd never worked together before.
No. So Tony Hopkins and Ian were in this film together. Now, Ian was sort of fine during rehearsal. We had 2 weeks rehearsal, which there was a huge amount of anecdotage because we're all in our 70s and, you know, have been working in theatres for 50-odd years. And so a lot of the rehearsals were spent in telling very, very funny stories about working in the theatre 50 years ago. We came to the first day we were shooting, Ian had two very, very long speeches, and we had to shoot about 4 minutes a day, which is quite a high proportion. And Ian, we started off, he said, I don't know who I am. I've no idea. I just don't. I'm just going, blah, 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 and I'm doing this funny voice, and I've got this funny walk, and why am I wearing this? And I thought, I've just got to stick with it, because he was exactly like that over 20 years ago when we did Richard III. Mm. And said, you know, why? I've got this kind of cripple, and I don't know if I can move. And what does this speech mean? What does it mean? And who am I? And Ian said he doesn't have a method. He does have a method, and his method is an empirical one, which is to be relentlessly self-critical and to examine himself and examine the text and examine the meaning of everything, including all the other performances, the whole universe that he finds himself in.
Oh, yes, that's right.
But I don't know if you're...
No. That is right. Yes, I recognize that. Mm. But of course, if you're not getting there, if you think you're not getting there, where's the ladder? Where's the strut? That's supporting you. But so You cling to each other, don't you? That's why we call each other darling in the theatre, you know. We need each other, and if we don't have each other, darling, love, sweetie, it's, you know, we have to be in love, not in love with each other, but we have to love each other, hold on to each other, cling together. Because people are probably going through different sorts of journeys, settled when they were at drama school, or never settled in the case of those of us who didn't. But just to finish off this little bit of indulgence, although the dresser, I think, was the last thing of any size merit I did, I'm about to do No Man's Land, Harold Pinter's play, which I did with Patrick Stewart on Broadway not long ago. We're going to revive it. I'm actively looking forward to it in a way that I've not looked forward to doing a play for a long time. I have had 9 months off. I've not been active for 9 months, so that may be part of it, but I do feel I've got a few things I want to try out.
Why do you think...
To try and be very real, Richard. Very real.
I know,
Not acted.
No, I know. I know, it's incredibly hard. This is what's hard about acting. Because you look around you, life is extraordinarily difficult to reproduce. And people are very, very eccentric and physically eccentric. And, you know, you just watch someone walking along the street. And so often you think, somebody does think something. I mean, let's take Donald Trump, for instance. You wouldn't dare put Donald Trump in a fiction. Nobody would believe Donald Trump in a fiction.
They wouldn't.
So it's just... observing is one thing, and playing it and being truthful, because it's all relative, isn't it?
Yeah. But do you not notice a lot of acting going on? Now, if you're going to the ballet and there's a lot of dancing going on, well, that's fine. But when you're doing a play that was written in the last 100 years and is written in a naturalistic mode, then what you want to look at is, isn't it people? Not someone pretending to be a person. Right. If you do pantomime or something exaggerated like that, well then half the fun is, yes, you can see the performer and you can see the performance and they're not quite the same thing. But when you go and see Pinter, don't you want to see those characters? Characters who you might never get to meet in real life, there they are, talking to you for an hour, 2 hours.
So has that been a process of discovery to arrive? Is that a sort of minimalism you've arrived at?
Yes.
Because when I first saw you on stage...
Big.
It was big.
Large.
No, bravura. Bravura, but it was thrilling. What you had was had a kind of bravura, kind of energy that was so alluring and magnetic.
Oh, well, that's lovely. That was based on the need I felt was required to make sure the people in the cheap seats at the back of the very large theatres that we used to tour, you know, 1,500 people maybe, and 500 of them a long way away, can't really see your face properly, so you have to give them a gesture and look up at them every so often. And that. So the people down here thought, ooh, that's rather... overacted, but it's sweet of you to say no. It was whatever it was. Did you say charismatic or divided?
No, but you had. I could have said that.
Bravura.
You had what seemed to me a sort of preternatural self-confidence. You didn't seem to me like an actor who was assailed by self-doubt, which was part of what was attractive.
Yes.
So but was that in itself acting?
I learned about a few basics about acting when I was 12. And we had a little theater at our school, half the size of this, with an auditorium of 50 people, and we had a little stage, and we used to put on plays all the time. And I worked out that if you were... if there were three people on the stage, the person at the apex of the triangle furthest from distance from the audience was in the best position. You'd think the further you were away, the worse you'd be, because the other two are downstage with you and have to play up to you, and the audience is there, so they had the disadvantage. I worked that out when I was 12, and I work with actors of my age now who haven't worked it out yet. And they're a pain to work with, because, I mean, you feel, do I have to start explaining to them what upstaging is? Now, in this, it's impossible to upstage in the round, but... I learned to feel comfortable, is what I'm saying.
Yes, but actually, you touch on something which I think completely separates good actors from bad. Good actors know how to occupy a space, and they always stand in the right relationship to the other actors. And the bad ones, wherever you tell them to go, it always feels like they're in the wrong place. They're just a lump. And it's very hard when you're... I find when directing that I direct in the sort of formal sense less and less. I do less and less of you move there, you move there, you move there.
Good.
I just let the actors move, and then I say, it just doesn't make sense when you... Why don't you try that? If you work with a group of good actors, they always form themselves into the most beautiful tableaus.
As human beings do in real life.
Exactly.
I mean, nobody blocks us in real life. I mean, you're blocked because you're all sitting down. But if there's a group of people, you block yourself. I mean, you all made a nice queue down there. Nobody told you it was three abreast, two abreast, four abreast. You just made those decisions, and you looked like a queue. Well, no, you suddenly get that same group of people on stage or on a film set, and they'd be all over the place. Where's the camera going to be, you know?
But it's also true of good actors that they know, they don't necessarily say, you know, what lens have you got, what size is the shot, but they have a sense of how to occupy a space.
Yeah.
So that if there's a two shot, I mean, it's very interesting seeing you and Tony together and adjusting so that one point in the two shot you favour him and then he favours you. And there's a beautiful sort of geometry.
A little dance going on.
And there's something to, I think, that connected with timing the whole use of the body. There's a very famous literary agent called Peggy Ramsey, who was the agent for, all the young writers of the 60s. Mm. And she used to say about comedy performances, look at the feet, dear, and they'll tell you whether they're funny. And it's true, because if you look at the feet, it's like a dancer's feet. Mm. They're kind of in the right place and in the right rhythm.
Very good.
And the ones who aren't funny, somehow their feet are in a different rhythm to their body.
So before you ask me, and maybe Richard, whether I prefer theatre or film, and I try and give some smart answer, I just observed to you that in a film, you never see the feet. There's no... You can discuss for hours what shoes you're going to wear in a movie. There's no point. No point. You have a look next time you see a movie. I bet you don't see the feet. In the theatre... In a conventional theatre, if you're on the front row, what's the first thing you see when somebody comes on? Feet! I don't know about you. Yeah, I look at the feet, then up to the crotch, and then to the face. If you get those three things right, and you may be on your way. But... but in the theatre, the silhouette, the entirety of the body, which I'm getting here in real life. We're very aware of the whole body and how someone's sitting and slumped. In a film, you may only see this bit. You can't tell what's going on. You can't tell whether the fingers are twitching. But in the theatre, everything's on display, and that's what I love. And that's often my way into a character, that I happen to be sitting in a particular way. And you've done it to me once or twice. I can't remember specifics, but you've come up to me after a scene and said, when you decided to not light the cigarette or whatever it was, absolutely right. And there's nothing more helpful than to be given that sort of note, that the observer has seen something that was absolutely in accord with the script. And once you've got that little thing, it might be a big thing, but once you've got that, you can, with your actor's imagination, spread it through the rest of your body. And I discovered, I knew all about DNA before anyone had discovered it. If you walk right, you'll probably talk right. And you'll probably think right and feel right. It's all connected. But these connections are not available.
Is the reverse true?
That what?
If you talk right and think right, that you'll walk right?
I would probably start with the body rather than the insides.
When we did Richard III, and I don't know if you've seen the film of Richard III, which was based on a theatre production that we did together, Ian and I started to talk about it long before we started rehearsing. And Ian drew a picture of how he thought Richard III was going to look. And we decided to set it in the 1930s, England in the 1930s, a kind of fascist state that never happened, but with a tyrant, sort of Hitlerian English tyrant. And I had recently directed a film about the Falklands War, about a man who had been a soldier who had been shot through the head and became paralyzed on one half of his body. And he was very, very vain. And when you weren't looking, he'd move his arm, this whole of this body, and he would get up, and he had educated himself and his body brilliantly. And I was telling, because we were discussing what Richard's disabilities were, and I told Ian this story, and I could see Ian lighting up the thought that he could do a performance with just use one hand, and the guy could have been a soldier, and a successful soldier, which Richard III is, and done it all with just one arm and one half of his body. And Ian drew this picture, and I still have this picture, of a guy with a very slight deformation here, but this arm by his side and the other arm here, and with a military hat on, and a military tunic. And that's where Ian started from. Once he had grasped the idea that this was going to be a man who couldn't use half of his body, then everything grew from that and grew into the most miraculously skillful and truthful performance.
And although that may sound like a praising me, in fact, Richard just revealed to you what a wonderful director he is. Because you knew what was required, the sort of thing that I would respond to. And it was clearly something that you cared about. Of course, you weren't pretending in any sense, but that's what I constantly find with you and other good directors, that they're Richard can hold a good party, and I think that's almost the definition of a director. You've got to get the cast list right. You've got to get the invitation list right. You've got to make sure everyone's going to get on together. Can't be any troublemakers there. And when they've all been invited, you've got to make sure you know what each of them drinks, what their taste is, what their background is, who they've left at home. And then you have to constantly be going around checking that everyone's all right and treating everyone a little bit differently or appropriately. That's what you do. You treat people appropriately. Whereas some directors think, probably out of fear, I must lay down the rules. I must tell them what is what. Here is what I am going to do. This is going to be quiet, everybody. Just give me half an hour, and I'll tell you exactly what I'm going to do and where you're all going to stand. And you know, your confidence of the actors just drains away because you think, am I going to be up to what is required? And Richard isn't always certain what's required. So there's an invention and there's a playfulness and there's a experimentation and all those wonderful positive lively goings on. But do you remember the scene where Richard is courting Lady Anne, the widow of the man he's just killed, and he successfully does it. But he does it by showing his bare chest. He refers to it in the text, so it's quite clear that Shakespeare intends Richard to show his skin. Half undress. Well, now that involved for me a great coat, did I not have on? A cap, gloves, a jacket, a Sam Brown, rather difficult thing to undo and do up. And all these had been removed during the course of the scene. And when Lady Anne left, we decided that Richard should join the soliloquy that followed to the audience, should start to get dressed again. Well, we were hampered because I could only use one hand. That was the rule we'd been given ourselves. It was my right hand. Oh, I think I had a sword as well, didn't I? Anyway, I had an awful lot. And I don't suppose anyone in the audience listened to a word I was saying as they admired this bravura acting that was going on. Anyway, the last thing that I did when I'd done all this and put the cap on was I got to get the glove on. Well, how do you get a glove on when you don't have a hand? Well, I think I used to tug it on. And one day I picked it up and just did that. And I could not believe, but the glove just fell down. And thereafter, I think perhaps any glove will work like that. It's a leather glove. I mean, have a go. It's a great trick. And and so at the end of that, the audience were very happy.
You've forgotten the final gesture. You put your hand in your pocket, took out a cigarette case.
Oh, did I?
Opened the cigarette case, put a cigarette in your mouth, put the cigarette case back, and lit the cigarette. And this was the speech, was ever woman in this manner wooed. And it was bravura.
In this humour wooed.
What?
In this humour.
In this humour, sorry. Humour.
Sorry. But let me, have you finished?
I was just going to say, the bravura of it was actually perfectly in tune with the characterization.
Yeah.
Because it was Richard saying, you think that I'm disabled, just watch this.
Yeah.
And
the point being that he's a great warrior, and it can be a puzzle, you know, if people are going around on crutches and absolutely disabled, you think, how on earth do they manage on a battlefield? But so that was our motive. We felt, no, this guy had conquered his disability. Anyway, so when we did all this, I'd forgotten about the cigarette. And I think I saluted, and I came to the end of the line, and as I walked off, there was a very gratifying scatter of applause. Now, we come to do it in Tokyo, at a theatre which is devoted to Shakespeare, where they only do Shakespeare all the year round, in all the languages of the world. We don't have such a place in the home of Shakespeare. There we are. So we were... The trouble with... the situation is that I couldn't see the audience. They were, the seats were rather taller than the people sitting in them. and they were very, very quiet and very, yeah, very polite, as Japanese people can so wonderfully be, respectful. But when I'd done all my nothing, absolute silence. Well, that's the way things are in Japan. Until the next day, I went to a matinee of the Kabuki Theatre. Now, the Kabuki Theatre is like pantomime multiplied by 10. People go for a whole day. They take sandwiches and chicken legs, sake, and they talk all the time, and they shout and they shriek, and when their favourite actor comes on, Ian Mckellen! And they get terribly excited. And when the actor goes off and has done his equivalent of my bravura. He before he goes, he looks into the audience at his fans and goes, and there goes. And that seems to be the signal for everyone to say, God bless your house forever, or whatever it is they're shouting. So, next night, after I got the glove on, I got the cigarette going, I lit it, and I went, and I promise you, the entire audience burst into applause. Did you not know that?
No.
So just remember that if you ever...
Strangely, I missed that. You've talked a lot about physical behaviour, but your accuracy, your fastidiousness about what you say is extraordinary. I mean, you're very, very precise and minutely detailed about words, about the use of words.
So are you, aren't you? I mean, you appreciate that.
I do appreciate that,
yeah.
And I find it extraordinary when people can't sense that a paraphrase is weaker than the original line.
Well, now, we both studied English at the same university, Cambridge, in our spare time, because we were both doing far too much theatre, I suspect. Is that right?
It is, but you see...
Do you not think that's where we might have got our taste for accuracy, etc.?
I don't know. I was so much an accidental student. I was the first person in my family ever to go to university.
Really?
And my father tried to stop me going to university. I can't say in public what he said. Oh, well, I'll paraphrase.
Go on.
But he said to me, why are you wasting your time going to university? You'd much better fuck your way around the world. Is what he said to me. So in defiance of my father, I was determined to go to university in order to read natural sciences.
Oh.
And then I copped out because I thought my maths wasn't good enough. And it so happened that the college I'd applied to had just taken on an English tutor called Kingsley Amis, the novelist. And so they hadn't got any students. So they said to me, would you like to read English?
Good Lord.
So that's how I became reading English literature. And I did act a lot, rather badly, as I later realised.
We would all be bad. Don't worry.
No. You were hugely gifted. It's true.
Yeah.
Anyway, the point I think that it is true that Ian and I, he is older than me, you know.
But until this point, you wouldn't have guessed, would you?
He had just left university when I got there.
That's right.
And you were a legend.
Ah.
Now, it's extraordinary how many people we know of that vintage who were at Cambridge University with us.
Yeah.
I mean, the whole of the Monty Python people, Graham Garden, Bill Oddie, these were all my contemporaries, Eric Idle, John Cleese, and directors.
Peter Cook.
Trevor Nunn.
Cook was my generation.
Peter Cook, yeah.
Jacobin.
There is something, it's not, you know, that it's a very beautiful place and very privileged place, but the reason I think so many actors and directors come out of Cambridge is because they had, subsidized by the university, a working theatre, which was a wonderful theatre, seated about 250, properly equipped theatre, where the students ran the theatre.
Mm.
And the students were funded to put on proper shows, weren't they?
Mm.
And so directors like, I directed film at university, I never directed theatre, but directors like Trevor Nunn made a career at Cambridge. Sam Mendes is another one. And Nicholas Heitner is another one.
Peter Hall.
Peter Hall.
John Barton.
And they just got Toby the Roberts. Experience of directing, and actors got the experience of playing big, big, big parts in a proper theatre where the stakes were very high because they were fellow students, and you could have a sort of career as an actor at university.
Yeah, yeah.
And I think that the lesson I draw from that is that this funding by the university was a funding of the arts, that it's a rich university. And I know that there's problem now with the funding here. And it is just shocking that our generation were so lucky. And this the new generation, the generation now in their early 20s, late teens, are so unlucky to have a government who is so ungenerous and unimaginative about funding the arts.
Absolutely. And
but you feel very strongly about it.
Sure, but of course I do, and short-sighted. And of course it goes beyond the point of education, because at the outset of a career, when we were starting out, you had to join the Actors Union, British Actors Equity. And if you're not already a student member, I would urge you to be, because the benefits are enormous. And for my generation, indispensable. In that you could not join Equity until you had done 44 years, 44 weeks, not continuous necessarily, but 44 weeks of work outside London, not on television, not in film. In other words, the only place you could work as a tyro actor would be outside London. And there, waiting for you, were all these regional theatres in every city and medium-sized town, funded by local authority, funded by central government through the Arts Council. That's the funding that's dribbled away. And, of course, it was in those 44 weeks that people like Derek Jacobi and Albert Finney and Judi Dench and many, many, many others discovered what they were good at and what they were not so good at, and watched other actors at close quarters and learned the whole business of what it was to be a professional. They weren't suddenly dubbed with stardom in a TV series or a lucky movie. They didn't find their way into the West End, where they got stuck in a long run. No, they were doing a different play every 2 or 3 weeks. Now, that has all gone. There is not a single regional company in existence. There's nowhere for you to go of that sort. And yet, when I drone on about this to people of your generation, eventually someone says, Ian, will you just shut up? You're talking about a world that's gone. Well, we can have regrets, can't we, about how wonderful it used to be in the old days. So what is positive about the current situation? I'm just trying to think. And one thing that is, I wonder if you think it's stretching it too far, is that because much more than we were, young people are thrown back onto themselves. There are no nets, there are no supports, there are no welcoming arms. You're on your own, with like-minded friends maybe. It could be that releases an energy and an individuality and a contribution maybe to drama as a whole that mightn't have emerged otherwise. Is that over-optimistic?
No, I think there's a huge amount of new writing in the theatre, because writers realise that it's hard to get into television, but when you do get into television, on the whole, it's not your voice that's being heard. So writers more and more love writing for the theatre. There's a huge profusion and expansion of young writers writing for the theatre. And there's a terrific movement to increase the gender balance in writing.
Yeah.
And in direction. And also, people are enfranchised by the fact that, you know, you can shoot a film with a mobile phone.
Isn't that brilliant? I mean, you can make a film this evening. It's incredible. And you don't have to go and be taught how to act in movies. You can teach yourself. Oh, I won't do that again. Oh, I see. Oh. Yep. No, it's wonderful, that. Absolutely wonderful. So I assume you're all making films all the time, are you? Because if you're not, think about it. I mean, see how difficult it is to write a scene. And then how difficult it is to decide where the camera should go. The acting parts were relatively easy, I think. No feet involved.
the thing that, when I'm asked what should an actor learn or what should a director learn, I always think the thing that I loved when I got into the theatre, professional theatre, as an actor, and then I gradually realised I simply wasn't good enough to sustain my expectations, fantasies. Two things. One, I thought it's wonderful to be working in this world where, for the first time in my life, I feel there is no discrimination on the grounds of gender or class or sexual orientation or age. I was, making friends with 80-year-old
unique
actors.
Unique, and that.
I was in a company.
Yeah.
And that I found wonderful. But the other thing I found wonderful is that I developed taste. And this is the thing that I don't know is taught enough. I mean, you can't teach someone taste, but you can say, look, what do you think is, what are the criteria of good acting? Why do you think this actor is good and this actor is not good? Mm. Or, I mean, I'm doing a review program for the radio on Saturday. So I went to see a movie yesterday as part of my job called The Nice Guys. Now, if there's anything I can do to prevent people seeing this film, I will. Stars two very good actors walking through it and collecting the check, Russell Crowe and Ryan Gosling. It's just appalling. And it's appalling, you look at it and you think, why aren't they bothering? Why has nobody bothered to write this film with any kind of intelligence and wit? And I think developing a critical mind, developing a way of looking at theatre and a way of looking at cinema, a way of a vocabulary of discussing performances, I think that's really important.
Well, now, look, I mean, you're talking about as a critic now, because temporarily you are being a critic on radio. But also you are a director and a producer who spent a lot of time casting people, observing people, making decisions before the event, and then conducting it, as it were. So taste is hugely important in making those decisions of who's going to do what and how they're going to do it. I think an actor could be very, very successful and have appalling taste. An unawareness of what of other people's qualities, let's say. They could be that selfish.
But do you not think it would show in the performances?
It probably would.
I mean, let's take an actor who you knew and you worked with, Laurence Olivier. Now,
who knows who Laurence Olivier was? I have to give a quick rundown.
Do you all know who Laurence Olivier was?
Well, look him up, anyway.
But he was somebody whose acting I was very sceptical of.
You were?
Yes. I saw him twice be really wonderful, but in both parts they played to his... what I thought of as his weaknesses, which is desire to show off, so that he was always going, oh, look at me, I am being remarkable. And
a very good imitation, but most people of our generation can do an imitation because we've been up close to him.
But I remember the shock in 1963 was the National Open, 63. And maybe I went to see his Othello, which I thought was terrible. But at the time, I was terribly impressed. But I went with a friend of mine who he was one of those people, sadly now dead, but he knew everything at the age of 18. He sort of seemed to be, you know, I've met a few people like that who have read every book and see. And he said to me, that performance is absolutely terrible. And then described to me why he thought it was a bad performance, an untruthful performance, a meretricious performance. And, you know, the scales fell from my eyes. And I think it's so useful to, I'm not, you know, to be iconoclastic, but for people to examine things and say, well, why? Do I really believe that?
Yeah, but, and also, connected with that is the opposite, that you can go and see performances and work out why they're good.
Yeah.
I mean, if you decide they're good, your taste has been exercised, then as a practitioner, you want to say, how the fuck do you do that?
Yeah.
And that's, if you're dropping any hints as to, from our experience, of what might be useful to you is, do go and see other people act. I mean, preferably every single day of your life. And you can do that, fortunately, because you can watch television, plenty of acting on television, and not always by actors, you know. Politicians, have a look at them. I've some news for you. All the world's a stage and all the men and women. So, and if you watch with a mate, I mean, really watch. And this day and age, you can play the performance back if it's on TV and see, were we right? Oh, my God, do you see what he did there? That's why it worked or why it didn't work or why it shouldn't have worked, or why it worked in the wrong way. So don't just depend on criticizing yourself. You may pick up, you're bound to pick up, tips as to what to do yourself, and also this taste, which Richard's talking about. So be an audience. I think if you must go on being an audience, and then when you come to entertain the audience, perhaps you'll have some hint as to what it is that would entertain them.
What do you do if, I'm very interested in the idea of resilience. I'm fascinated by the fact that politicians spend most of their lives being abused or being being held in contempt.
Bad reviews all the time.
Bad reviews.
Every
and
day.
And yet they have to resist it. They have to show some kind of stoicism. How do you develop that? I remember Judy Dench, who is a great friend of ours, a young woman coming up to her and say, I very much want to be an actress. What do I most need? And Judy said, you need to be prepared to accept failure. Mm. But how do you deal with that?
Oh, I don't know. It's you.
Is it so long ago since you had a thing?
Well, you know, I have had a charmed career because I've never been out of work, unless I wanted to be. I've had a constant supply of wonderful challenges, and on the whole, in John Osborne's words, the playwright Ian Mckellen is a critic's actor. Critics can tell from my performances what copy they should write. I'm signalling, I'm waving, I'm, get this? There's quite a lot of that in my acting, or has been. But that aside, but there are politicians who collect the cartoons of them, which show them to be idiots, pernicious, horrible people, and they collect them for their walls. They're trophies, you see. They like the attention. No such thing as a, what's the word, as bad news?
Bad review?
No.
Bad publicity?
Bad publicity, yeah, no such thing as bad publicity. They like being talked about, even if they, as long as their families are nice to them and their immediate colleagues, maybe they don't mind if the rest of the world hates them. But, you know, there is no point in being an actor unless the audience not loves, not likes even, but gives you the time of day. You're doing it. We're doing it for the audience. And if you go through all the pain and the heartache and the trouble and the hard work and the sleepless nights and you give the performance and they reject it by their indifference, represented by a bad review or two, well, my God, then you need your friends and then you need to be able to say, love, darling, sweetie, and cling together. Because it's dreadful. Mm.
So are you saying
that... And the reverse, of course, is glorious if it's all working
out. Yes. Mm. Are you saying that you need approbation? I mean, you do obviously you do.
And I need it from my parents, who are both long dead. But I'm acting for
them.
Did
you get it?
Well, my mother died long before I became an actor. My father died shortly after I became an actor. So there weren't any bad times when they were just there holding on, you know. So that didn't apply to me.
But is it too simplistic to say that an actor is looking for love? I mean, you are looking for approbation.
Yes.
I remember being on stage with you, the end of performance, and I went on stage. We were in Bucharest, and the audience went absolutely crazy. I came on stage, made a speech, and then the audience went on, and you said to me, "Bow, you bow." And it sort of clicked that this business of the approbation, of earning the approbation of an audience. I mean, in my case, where I wouldn't say had a loveless childhood, but harsh in the sort of not getting a lot of love. And so for me, I always think, and I remember sitting by my father when we were working together. My father died, and I said to you, I must go and see him before he is taken out of the house. And I sat by his dead body, and I thought, all this stuff I've been doing, and I was running the National Theatre then, is in order to impress you, and I never succeeded in doing it. So, but my theory breaks down, because I don't think you were unloved, and Judy is definitely had the most idyllic childhood. No.
Well, then she wants to go on having
an idyllic childhood.
An idyllic
right?
childhood, yeah. Yeah. I mean, the play, wonderful word, isn't it? Playing like a kid does and playing like grown-up adults do on as actors. Play. And if you lose contact with that easy ability that all children seem to have to play, to imagine, to pretend, to be something other than they're not, and to relish that and feel as they are playing that this is life. If you lose that, then you're probably not going to be a very good actor. So that so maybe with that that childlike virtue, you're stuck with some less attractive childish qualities of be nice to me, but I. You know, we've all seen performers who want to be loved. And you want to vomit. what I want is for the whole enterprise to be loved, for the play to be loved and appreciated and understood, and the fact that we're all gathered together, strangers and friends, brought together for 2 hours. In the hope that our minds are going to be shifted a tiny little bit and we're going to leave different people and no longer strangers, but we have that shared experience, which is a wonderful word for that theatre company. So that's where I want the love to be centred. It's not on me. And actors get far too much attention.
But do you think... You see, I don't think...
And I don't think it's very good for us.
I don't think that's good for us. But actors, most good actors I know, are not natural exhibitionists.
Ah, no. Absolutely, which is why they're actors.
Yes, in fact, most are quite shy, slightly socially uneasy, and have to take a deep breath. And it's a wholesale misconception by journalists to think that they are constantly seeking attention for themselves.
Absolutely, absolutely true. And they land, they discover acting as a way into a security which they don't feel when they're not acting. And for a little gay boy at a time when it was against the law to be gay in this country, as it is in India where I've just returned from, and as it is in China where I'm going to on Saturday, and as it is in Russia pretty well the week after, I escaped into professional acting because it was there that I was not only allowed, but it was expected that I would emote and express my inner life in a way that I wasn't allowed to do by the law of the land in what passed for real life. So I was extremely shy when I was, and I'm now only not shy. Well, I suspect if I weren't on occasion recognized by strangers at a party where I don't know anybody, I would shrink back into being that little boy who couldn't wait for the party to end.
Talking of which, I think this party should open itself up to questions. A few cues from the audience, and we'll try to give A's.
You've got a microphone upstairs as well. Here we are.
Have you been playing upstairs?
I haven't. No.
Well, there they are.
This is a note that one always gives actors after the first performance. Say, could you just remember that there's half the audience is up there and you never look at them?
And what I do if I'm with the company, whether I'm producing it or just in it, I say, come on, who's coming up when we arrive in a new town? Let's go to the back of the gallery. And then the director doesn't need to give that note because it's only patently, obviously, when you're up there and you're looking down at a postage stamp, that there are responsibilities.
So who's got a question? Yes, there. You can just project.
Hello. Well, actually, I'm a stage manager, not an actor, so, yeah. Well, you've just come out with this wonderful new Shakespeare app to help people, you know, understand Shakespeare and hear
you know
it from
no.
from an actor's voice and actually understand it. And I was just wondering, where did you get your inspiration for this and what made you want to create something like
well,
this?
What's your name?
I'm Bryn Newell.
Bryn.
Brilliant, thank you, because if you hadn't mentioned it, I might have forgotten. And well, I have forgotten to bring it with me.
Well, don't look at me.
No, no. But I'm going to explain to you what it is. It is so simple, you think, why wasn't it thought of 100 years ago? Well, because the tech. For $4.99, you download an app of The Tempest, and you've got the text here, and as it scrolls up, speaking the text across the top, and you can see them doing it, looking straight out at you, are actors. I play Prosper. Derek Jacobi is Gonzalo. Frances Barber is a goddess, I believe. And many other actors, all of whom have been in The Tempest and have brought with them their knowledge of the play. It's not a production we're giving. It's not even a performance. It's a clear reading following the strictures of the verse and so on that we understand, so that someone looking at the word can hear it spoken by an expert. Now, if you don't speak English very well, it's a boon, and if you do, it's equally helpful because Shakespeare did not intend these plays to be read by anybody other than the people who had to learn the lines. It's patently obvious. I mean, Shakespeare as an examination subject is anathema to me. And this is not no substitute for going to see a play in the theatre where they belong, but it's a great aid. And if there's something you don't quite understand, you stop the app. And the Arden edition, the Arden being the best edition of Shakespeare, all the Arden notes are on here, divided between learners, mid-school and advanced students. There are running commentaries by the actors and by Jonathan Bate, who's professor of Shakespeare at Oxford University. There's a timeline of what was going on in England and the world at the time and so on. It's like studying The Tempest and having about 8 or 10 books around it, which you now don't need because they're all in the app. And if it works, well, it does work because people love it. But if it sells, more to the point, then we'll do more. And I think...
So is it now just The Tempest?
Just The Tempest, yeah.
And whose idea was it?
Well,
I think it was...
I don't think it was. I don't really know. I was so immediately enthusiastic about it that I probably had nothing to do with it other than to be asked, did I want to be involved? Richard Longcrane, who I always used to call Richard II because he was the man who directed Richard III, which this Richard had done originally. and didn't have time to do the film because he was running the National Theatre. Longcrane was not a Shakespeare aficionado, partly because he was dyslexic. Isn't that ridiculous? This dyslexia should keep you from Shakespeare?
Incredible.
You're an audience, audio, something to do with reading. Anyway, poor old Richard has not had Shakespeare in his life because he'd been to see a few productions and not enjoyed them and put off it at school. And he's got an inventive mind, and I think he came up, said, could we not make an app which would make it easy for people to read Shakespeare? And then we discussed it and came up with this.
Richard invented those desk games that, you know, the bouncing balls that have on strings that echo.
You drop this one, and this one comes up.
Yeah.
Actually, he didn't invent it. It was Isaac Newton.
Wow.
He
marketed.
Exactly.
Very brilliant.
And financed his films through it.
Let's have another question. Up there, yeah.
Yes.
I'm good.
Yeah. No, it does. There's such a huge difference. I often get asked whether I prefer working in film or theatre. They're so different. The thing is, the theatre, at the centre of a piece of theatre, you have the human body and the human voice, and that's absolutely irreducible. That is at the heart of the art form, human body that is of roughly, you know, between 5 and 6 feet, and a live audience, and it's that relationship. And so it always has a humane property.
Yes.
You can't make abstract theatre.
No.
It just doesn't make sense. There is always a human being and the humanity and the vulnerability at the centre. And the other thing is that the audience, except in a theatre like this, have a fixed point of view. You see two people from the same angle. In a film, you're constantly changing the size. You have, you know, a screen 20 feet high. You have a face that is 20 feet high. Then you have a body that is, you know, a little matchstick. Then you go from that angle and you go from that angle. The sound sometimes plays, you know, quite often you're watching, you're not watching the speaker in film. You can edit, you can change the tempo, you can move time, you can make time pass slowly, you can make time pass fast, you can use music expressively. But theatre is much more imaginative because it conscripts the imagination of the audience. And you can say, I can change a hat. I can say, I am, you know, Julius Caesar. I put on a different hat, now I'm Mark Antony. And you can, if I'm a good actor, you accept it. You can say, I'm now in 50 BC. And now I'm in the year 2016. That is the theatre. And if you...
Sir? Now's the winter of our discontent. Come on, come on. We're all in this together. Oh, it's thrilling, absolutely thrilling. And engaging them and telling them. And of course, the secret to a soliloquy is that it has no secrets. It's the character telling the truth. Whatever he does in the rest of the play, when he's speaking, now I am alone. Says Hamlet, oh, what a rogue and peasant slave am I. Ooh, you're right inside. That's why Iago is the easiest part to play in the world, and I can't commend it strongly enough to don't play Othello. Ooh. But Iago, because Iago is simply the nicest man you've ever met in the world, honest Iago, kind Iago, thank you, Iago, help me, Iago, anything you can do, Iago, oh, thank you, Iago. And the man's a shit. But he doesn't act it. He acts the nice man. So you act the nice man. Lovely. Then they all leave the stage and you say there. And then he tells the truth. It's so simple. So a soliloquy is a gift. I'm not sure about a monologue on its own. That's another matter.
You have to talk to the audience.
Oh, yeah.
But I remember a story of Tom Stoppard was asked a similar question. And Tom thought very deeply. He said, well, there was a play of mine that had a very, very, very long speech by a young woman. And it was always a problem in English productions. And I went to see, it opened in Paris, and I went to see the production. And this long speech was the centerpiece of the production. It was a huge success with the Parisian audience. And I said, well, Tom, what happened? He said, well, during the speech, this girl just took off her clothes. So article by article, stretched out the whole, and she ended up completely naked. Huge success.
Oh, absolutely wonderful. I'm going to try that. No longer.
Let's have another question. What do you do to regain the trust in yourself when you lose confidence in yourself as an actor?
Oh, well, I personally don't lose confidence. I have great difficulty in rehearsal getting to the point where I'm ready to meet an audience. But if there's a problem thereafter or before, Richard, help. That would divide out the good and the not so useful directors. Can they just help? And it might just be listening to the moan, but what more likely would be, well, Ian, you've forgotten that what you did in rehearsal one day that was so good. Oh, yes. Or your director might just run you through your story in the play or part of it. Just a friend. And the director's always there, as your friend, in a way that another actor can't be because they're too partial. Or a friend coming to see the show can't be because they don't know enough about it. The director, I am enthralled to directors. I think the directors are wonderful ideas, but it's a wonderful notion to have a friend like that around all the time. Director in the sense of not someone who's going to go on the journey with you necessarily, but will say, look, what about going over there? That might be quite good. Might be a nice view from over there. I'll come with you a bit. But so that's...
I think that the director always has to
where
remember...
Yes, where do you go?
Well, the director has to remember that in the end, the director isn't performing. That actually the job of the director, or part of the job, is to hand over the power to the actor. Because if you don't, if the director has still got their hands on the actor, it's never going to work.
No.
The actor is there, they're being... An audience is a very... we're all quite judgmental. You know, you look at someone and say... And you're assessing the performance, but you're also assessing the person. You're just thinking that person. And when you're watching, you sort of think, well, Ian McKellen is, for the time I'm watching, Richard III. So if you're criticizing his performance in some way, you're criticizing him. So you have to be prepared for actors to feel quite suddenly, and you can't predict when it's going to happen, suddenly terrible chasms of fear open up. And you've got to be prepared to soak up the fear and just listen and say, yeah, sure, but I can tell you, you're fine. Just go. And when it's combined with an actor who is having trouble remembering lines, it's a really perilous time. Mm. And there is a lot of hand-holding. And if you're not prepared to do that, then you shouldn't be a director.
Mm, that's right.
Let's take, I think, one more question, Michael, yeah? So I just don't know. I'm going to let Michael choose this next questioner. over there, behind you.
Well, it's always difficult, that, because if you don't know the person in question, I mean, if I'd seen a young actor act, I might be able to make some specific thing that would be of help about why don't you think about your gait a bit more and how you walk. I do think that's a wonderful thing for actors to think about. You know, everybody walks differently. Yeah, well, good for you. No. It's underestimated. Everybody walks differently. Everybody looks differently. This is my philosophy of life. Everybody is different. But we should all be treated the same. So as you're walking down the street, on the tube, anywhere, doesn't matter where you are, look out the window of the bus, there are people walking, and they're giving you acting lessons for free. And I tell you, if you can get the walk right, to go back to what we were saying before, you'll get the thought right. I mean, you can, by copying the way somebody walks, begin to understand their aches, their pains, their age maybe, their preoccupation, even the way they might talk and think.
But you've got to keep your eyes open.
Oh, yes. I
find it shocking, even more so now that I'm of an age, how sometimes you get students who say, oh, I'm playing an old person, and they go. And you think,
well, not
how so, old?
Not even as I good mean, as that, yeah.
It's just because it's a sort of later old, oh, that means you're... Whereas, of course, we are two examples of two vain old men. And the last thing in the world we want to do is be seen creeping about like that.
Yeah. It's like when you're playing drunk. Usually you have to play not drunk. Because someone drunk doesn't want to be thought of as drunk, so there's constant try not to be drunk. And it's the same with us constant trying to be. We're just stretching. But look, can I just say something from my heart, which doesn't apply to Richard, but which is this business of us all being the same, should be treated the same. We're not the same. Thank God we're not so. Variety, spice of life, everything else. But you do have the opportunity as an actor and as a director and as a writer to just observe and get inside other people's insides. And it's so interesting. It'll tell you something about yourself. But I suppose I was going to have a little rant about being gay and being nice to gay people. And it used to be, you know, that when John Gielgud, a great contemporary of Laurence Olivier's, was found guilty of importuning in a public place, that some members of Equity, the Actors Union, without whom in those days you could not be a professional actor, tried to remove him from the union. They didn't succeed. He was not, however, allowed to go to America for 10 years after that. He was absolutely... and died still unreconciled to the misery of the way society had treated him. He was this great star, this great elegant man who wouldn't... you'd have thought... been anything but a positive help, rejected by the law. Why am I saying all this? Well, because it's thought that in our business, it would be probably better if you didn't talk about your sexuality, unless you're straight, of course, but in which case you can talk about it the whole time. Because somehow the audience won't accept you as an actor if they know you're gay. That's the prevailing view in Hollywood. And I've heard Rupert Everett and others say it in this country. And I just say, if you're gay or if you're different, will you just express your difference and be yourself, because without it you're not going to enjoy your life. And if you find you can't be a successful romantic actor in Hollywood movies, and how many of those are there at any one time? Three? And there's a choice between that ambition and being open in yourself. Go for being yourself and forget acting at that level. And the other thing is, and I'm sure Richard would agree with this, you're a member of Equity, aren't you?
Yeah.
Yes, automatically. A director is a member of Equity. Please consider joining Equity. Get someone down from Equity to tell you the merits, if you don't believe me. But we have to stick together in this business. And one way of doing that is through a union of people who know what working conditions should be and know how to make them better and have improved them over the years. And it's so unfair for you to... go and be and sign a contract which has been drawn up by Equity and not at least recompense Equity for the hard work it's done over the generations to get to that point at which you do get a holiday salary and some overtime and proper conditions of work. That's the business of being a professional. It's playtime. Yes, it's playtime if you're lucky and for the rest of your life, but it's playing as adults and looking after each other. And that's a huge part of what is possible in a theatre company and on a film set and in a studio. And it's...
And be stoical.
Be stoical.
I think we should end. Thank you very much for coming.
All right.